is history, then you got to decide whether or not you're going to listen and obey. Now, God ain't just telling you something. He's telling you to do something. And when he tells you to do it, it requires action.
Thank you. Welcome to Brentwood Baptist Church, the church where Christ is the main attraction. Whether you are virtual or in person, we are so excited you're here. You can find us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. You can also stay updated by texting Brentwood to 41372 to join our text club. Here's what's happening at the Wood. If you did not get a chance to schedule 60th Year Jubilee Church Directory photos, we have scheduled a limited number of additional appointments on May 21st through 25th. The remaining appointments are already filling up quickly, so schedule as soon as possible to secure your preferred date and time. You can schedule appointments by going on our website or the weekly e-blast. If you need additional assistance, schedule your appointment by stopping by the table today for help or contact Augusta Green at 713-852-1485. The Brentwood Community Foundation presents its 42nd annual scholarship fundraiser, a virtual event. Please help support deserving college students by making a contribution to the foundation. You can make checks payable to Brentwood Community Foundation and mail them to P.O. Box 450088, Houston, Texas 77254. Or visit bcfscholarship.org for more information. The Brentwood Baptist Church will be participating in a joint choral concert with the Memorial Drive Presbyterian Church on today at 6 p.m. The concert will feature four choirs: Brentwood Baptist Church, North Houston Children's Choir, and Memorial Drive Presbyterian Sanctuary and Children's Choir. The concert will feature the Dan Forrest Requiem for the Living and John Rutter's Mass of the Children with full orchestra. The concert is a free event. Our very own Dr. Jeremy Jackson will conduct a movement from the Dan Forrest Requiem. Please come out and support our BBC Mass Choir and Music Ministry. For more information, please go to the website or see Dr. Jeremy Jackson immediately after worship. Boston Scientific, in collaboration with BBC, is inviting men only to a health seminar covering issues such as prostate cancer, ED, and the latest treatment options. Dr. Travis Green, a tenured urologist at Baylor University, will present Saturday, April 20th at 11:30 a.m. at the LLC. Lunch will be served. Pre-registration is required. Call 713-808-9669 to register or pass by the receptionist desk for more information. You can also contact Augusta Green for more information. The Brentwood Baptist Church Federal Credit Union will hold its annual shareholders meeting in person on April 21st at 1 p.m. in the LLC. The Gulf Coast Regional Blood Center needs 1,000 donations every day of the year to serve patients in our community. Giving on an ongoing basis helps ensure blood components are always available. Do your part to help save a life by donating blood on Sunday, April 21st, here on the campus of Brentwood from 10:30 a.m. to 2 p.m. in their mobile blood unit, which will be parked in our parking lot. To register, scan this QR code or visit the website for more information. Knowing the value of being screened regularly for stroke and cardiovascular disease risk is important. So Brentwood and Lifeline Screening has partnered to give you peace of mind for early detection. Preventative health screenings help people understand their risk for developing chronic conditions before symptoms are present, while they can still take action. Get the comprehensive stroke and cardiovascular disease risk package at a low cost of $139, a $200 value, right here on the Brentwood campus at the LLC on April 23rd. Schedule your screening by calling 1-888-808-9006 to speak with a preventative healthcare advisor. Pre-registration is required. Pass by the receptionist desk for more information. Brentwood members and visitors, the Intercessory Prayer Line invites you to join us in lifting prayers for this country on the National Day of Prayer, Thursday, May 2nd, 2024. We're asking you to participate by forming teams of two or more, or even a single individual. This will be a drive-by event for those working in teams, or you may walk your community alone or with a team. For more information, contact Dr. Pickings at 713-852-1400. The Intercessory Prayer Line Ministry will be hosting this year's observance of the National Day of Prayer with a prayer walk May 2nd from 10 a.m. to 12 noon. This year, we will walk around our church campus praying for churches, communities, families, local and national governments, schools, places of employment, and other areas of concern. The theme is Lift Up the World, Light Up the World. Please join us. We will initially meet at the LLC for opening prayer. That date again is May 2nd from 10 a.m. to 12 noon. Did you know Brentwood has a Veterans Assistance Ministry? It's established to provide support and resources for the veterans of Brentwood. Visit the table today for more information. The tables in the grand hallway is for the pictorial directory, and the table in the carport is for the voting information. Are you looking for a church home? Visit BrentwoodBaptist.org to become a part of our amazing family. If you're already a member, visit the website to learn how you can get involved. We thank you for choosing to worship with Brentwood Baptist Church, the church where Christ is the main attraction.
Good morning, Brentwood. As April blooms with new possibilities, embrace this season of renewal and restoration. Let the words of Jesus from Acts 20:35 inspire you that it is more blessed to give than to receive. Experience the joy of generosity. Experience the blessing of giving. Here are the ways you can give.
You can download and use the PushPay app. Text Brentwood to 77977. Drop off your offering at the church's receptionist desk or mail it in. Give using direct deposit and place your offering in one of the giving boxes in the worship center.
Your contributions support our mission of spreading love, hope, and compassion. Together, let's make April a month of abundant giving. And now, back to the worship service at the church where Christ is the main attraction.
Thank you, Sister Lindsay. And we are so happy to be here. I thank each one of you who, as you've already come in, have dropped your monetary gifts in those boxes that are all around the room, receptacles. And we want to remind you also, just as you were also told, it is more blessed to do what? Than to receive. Amen. Amen. I know y'all enjoy getting, but it's also good to give. And so for those who have not yet dropped your offerings in those receptacles, you may do so on your way out, or you may be already ahead of me by having done one of the six ways of giving. Amen. If anyone is with us today for the very first time, we're going to ask you to stand so that we might see you and welcome you to Brentwood Baptist Church. Any first-time visitors in the house? First-time visitors? Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Please remain standing until our ushers give to you a visitor's card. We are delighted that you pressed your way to Brentwood Baptist Church this morning. Once you get those cards, you may be seated. Again, thank you. Please complete them and drop, and you may leave them at your seat or you may give them to an usher, however you feel led, just so we get them and we can contact you and say thank you for coming this morning. And for those of you who may be viewing us or streaming and you're here in the room with us this morning, thank you for being a first-time visitor. And if you know how, just go to the chat and put a few, just say I'm a visitor. And I promise you, one of our members will respond. And you see on the screen our link for visitors if you need more information. Or there's even a link if you decide you want to join Brentwood Baptist Church. Please do so by scanning the QR code that will appear on your screen. Amen? Amen. Thank you so much. We wish to, at this time, read our scripture for this morning. You know what? I'm off track. Just a minute. We're not going to read the scripture. We are going to invite Mrs. Pamiel, I always mispronounce your name, Pam. That's why I say Pam. Miss Pam Gaskin, to come up. She's going to speak with us about voting in the general election. Pam.
Good morning. Good morning. I have bad news. The March 5th primary, in the state of Texas, there are 17.9 million registered voters. In the March primary, 1,800,000 voted. That's 10%. Now, if 10% of everybody voted, you know that our Black people, you know we voted at less than that. That is not acceptable. Now remember this, I just want to share something with you because I read this in the Houston Defender this week and I thought this is perfect to share on this Sunday because voting and citizenship is all of our business. We all have a stake in it. We all have to do something and we all can do something. Remember this, at the end of the day, you may not like either candidate, but this is not a popularity contest. Activist Jeff Johnson said the following, this is a quote, "There are very few people on the ballot that I like, and I don't necessarily trust them to do anything beyond what they've already shown me that they're going to do. But what I know is three things are going to happen. Laws are going to get passed, money is going to get spent, and judges are going to be appointed." Now, I ain't got to like them, trust them, go out to dinner with them, drink with them, or even hang with them. But I do know this, I need to make sure that the money gets spent, at least has the opportunity to get spent on more of the stuff that positively impacts my family. I need to make sure that the laws that get passed, even if they don't serve me, they don't kill anybody that I love or rob the people that I love of the stuff they need. And I know that I want judges because I got a lot of folk in my family that's going before judges that at the very least will see people for who they are versus deciding who people are before they even open their mouth or hear anything about their case. Those three things are going to happen whether you turn out to vote or not. We have to make sure to have a say in who's spending the money, who's appointing the judges, and who's passing the laws. I am begging you, to share this with young people, with old people my age who say my vote doesn't count. Share this, three things. Money's gonna be spent, judges are gonna get appointed, and laws are gonna get passed. And we don't have to, we're not voting for a pastor, we're not voting for a friend, we are voting for our lives, to improve the lives of our people. So vote on May 4th, there is a special election for the Central Appraisal Districts. For those of you who own homes or property, you get taxed. And there's a new way that we're gonna manage appraisal districts. So those folks are on the ballot. Please go and vote. And in Fort Bend County, you're also voting on school board. And then we have to go back to the polls on May 28th, because that's the runoff from the March primary. And in fact, I think on May 4th, if you're in Harris County, you have a special election to fill John Whitmire's seat. That's a state senate. So please, we got to vote twice. Don't say, I got a graduation, I got a wedding, I got an anniversary, I got this, I got that. We have early voting. Early voting starts for the May 4th primary on the 22nd of April. Early voting starts for the May 28th, right after we finish with the May 4th election. So, you're not giving up anything? Go vote. See me out here if you need to make a change to your voting registration, or you want to pick up a to-go. I have some little things that you can give to the young people in your families to have them register to vote. So see me out there. Thank you. Remember, money, laws, judges, those three things.
Lift him up, hallelujah.
To magnify the Lord. Amen. Amen. That's John Humphreys and the Brentwood Baptist Church male chorus. Amen. And you can't leave out the band. The band. Let's hear it for the band. Amen. John, that was a sister on the drums, huh? That's all right. Amen, amen. And we're just going to keep on magnifying the Lord, aren't we? Amen, yes we are. We're going to magnify next through a scripture, and that scripture is taken from Romans, the 8th chapter, verses 22 through 30. The New International Version of the Bible reads, "We know that the whole creation has been groaning as in the pains of childbirth right up to the present time. Not only so, but we ourselves who have the first fruits of the Spirit groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for our adoption to sonship, the redemption of our bodies. For in this hope we were saved, but hope that is seen is no hope at all. Who hopes for what they already have? But if we hope for what we do not yet have, we wait for it patiently. In the same way the Spirit helps us in our weakness. We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us through wordless groans. And he who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for God's people in accordance with the will of God. And we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. And those he predestined, he also called. Those he called, he also justified. And those he justified, he also glorified." Amen, amen. And we stand on the promises of God. Amen. How great thou art. This week, as we enter in prayer today, and as you go into your prayer closets, we ask that you pray for Francis Hill, who is ill. And I'm going to add to that Sister Diane Fuller, who had surgery just this past week. I know we had her on the list last week, but she had surgery this week. So we're going to keep praying for her. Amen. And then we want to lift up the bereaved families among us in the loss of Cherry Ford. She is the wife, she's our member also, but she's also the wife of Brother James Ford. And we ask that you pray for that family. That funeral service will be on Saturday, this coming Saturday, April 20th at 11 a.m. in the prayer chapel. In the sanctuary. Amen. Let us prepare to go to God in prayer. May we bow. Eternal God, our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Set apart is your name, Lord. Oh, we just come so glad that you made a way with a vehicle called prayer that we might be able to speak to you and do you speak back to us, Lord, that we might be enabled to make requests and that you might answer those requests with gifts and just in so many ways support, uplift, by giving us your joy, and even as the scripture just said, by glorifying us, Lord. Thank you for your presence in our life. and your presence to us as gifts, Lord. You are so wonderful. We lift you up. You are amazing. You are truly all that we can even ask or think about, Lord. We thank you that we are your children and the sheep of your pasture. And we have come into your house this morning, Lord, just praising you, for you are worthy of our praises. We come right now lifting up those families that are on that sick and shut-in list, Lord. Those who've been on the last few weeks, Lord. We just pray, Lord, that you continue to touch, Lord, and to make whole, to lift up off of beds of sickness and illness, Lord, to heal diseases, Lord. Oh, to uplift families who are bereaved, Lord, and who don't even know how they will continue, Lord. Help them to know that you have given them the ability to hope and the ability to have your joy, the joy that you set before them, Lord. Oh, Father, we thank you for your perfect peace that can calm any pain, Lord. Thank you, Father, for your presence that brings that joy, Lord, unspeakable. We thank you, Father. We come right now just recognizing all of the ones that are adding to your worship this morning with singing, with playing of instruments, with speaking, in all the ways that we acknowledge you, dear Lord. We come lifting up the preacher of the moment, Lord, asking that you be what he stands in need of, that he might be able to deliver that which you have given him, Lord. Prepare hearts and souls to receive that word, Lord, that it may fall on good ground, that it might refresh and renew a soul, Lord. We thank you, Lord, because we know you're more than able, Lord. Not only do we pray for the saint, the mouthpiece that will stand in this place, Lord, but we pray for our pastor as he stands, for he continuously goes forth, even in other places, delivering your word, Lord. We pray for his strength, Lord, and we pray for Sister Radliff as she supports him, Lord. Thank you for your goodness. Thank you for ministry, Lord, and ministers. Thank you for our shepherd and this flock, Lord. We come right now lifting up our children's church that is just across this campus, Lord. Bless every child and every family represented, Lord. Stretch every mind to be able to believe and stand on your promises, Lord. We pray for every young person in this church and this community, Lord. We pray for their future, that they might be able to embrace the only true and living God through our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. We pray for those that stand in need of the moment of baptism, Lord. And we pray, Lord, that you lead them and guide them, Lord, so that they know everything they stand in need of. And then, Father, as we just continue to walk the walk that you have given us before the foundations of this world, we pray for our members, Lord, one by one, as they go out into the world, sharing their testimonies and sharing their love for you. Oh, Father, you are truly amazing. We thank you for our visitors today, whether in person or in virtual reality, Lord. We just thank you that you are able to speak and make known, that you are able to lift up and give joy, that you are able to touch lives and rebirth. Oh, Father, we just thank you. We know you're able, and we praise you. Speak now, Lord, that your servants are listening, Lord. Oh, Father, we will give you all the glory and all the praise. It is in the blessed name of our Lord and Savior Jesus that we do pray, and to thine be the glory forever and ever. Amen. As we await the word of God, I wish to say a few words about our preacher of the hour. He is one of our faithful ministers here at Brentwood Baptist Church in the person of Reverend Albert Kemp. Reverend Kemp is a director here and a facilitator for our new members orientation group, He works with congregational development and evangelism. He is a strong advocate of assimilating new members into the body of Christ. And outside of this place, he is a director for Methodist hospitals in the area of chaplaincy. So we ask that you begin now praying for him, that God will speak a word through him as a vessel that will touch your lives and let you leave here different than the way you've come. It is in the holy name of Jesus that we ask that. Amen. After this choir sings, the next voice you hear will be that of our preacher of the hour, Reverend Albert Kemp.
Of glory shall God be praised. We are thankful for Brother Sean Humphreys and our male chorus doing such a wonderful job this morning. Let's give them a hand clap of praise. How we're grateful for you being here, and to all of our congregants, our trustees, deacons, our staff ministers and associate ministers, and we're just thankful to be here. And also to our beloved pastor. We want to just, let's give our pastor a big hand of praise. Such a great personality, great person, a great leader. And we're just thankful that he allows us to serve in our capacity here at the Brentwood Baptist Church. Amen, amen. I got a gang here this morning. I want y'all to know where they are so you won't say nothing negative about me around them. Where's my gang at? I got a gang here. Hold your hands up. Where's my gang at? There they are. No, not you. Not thank you being on my team, though. But I got another gang. I got another gang around. I got a wife around. There they are. Okay, thank you. I got another one around here somewhere too. There she is. I see her hand up. Hold your hand up again. Thank you, ma'am. Okay, she's back there in the gated community. Amen. Amen, amen, amen. We want to call our attention briefly as we can to Romans 8 and 28. A very familiar passage of scripture, and that reads, "And we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose." Amen, 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 amen. And we're going to talk about we know. What do you know? We know. What do you know? Well, have you ever been disappointed? Disappointed in yourself, disappointed in your spouse, your mate, disappointed in your best friend, disappointed in life? If you have not, just keep living long enough and you will be. Because everything and everybody will eventually disappoint you. But the worst disappointment of all is when you are disappointed with God. Even the greatest people in the Bible had times when they felt like God did not come through for them. You know what I'm talking about. Sometimes you have a physical ailment and you are in a lot of pain and suffering, and you ask God to heal you, but you are still unhealthy. You prayed for your marriage to work, but the divorce papers came in the mail. You prayed for a loved one to live, but that loved one died. You prayed to get that job and leave the unemployment line, but you did not get the job and you are still unemployed. How about this? You wake up feeling that you are going to have a bad day. You ask God to make it a good day. You walk out of the house believing it will be a good day, but it turns out to be a bad day. Believe me, there are some telltale signs it is going to be a bad day. Let me just share with you a few of them. Your blind date turns out to be the girl you just broke up with. You were in a Donald Trump tweet. The light at the end of the tunnel runs you over. Not good, not good. You got so low, you went to a fortune teller, and the fortune teller offered you a refund. The pest exterminator crawls under your house and never comes out. Not good, not good. You're offered a senior citizen discount, but you're only 35 years old. A black cat runs right in front of you and drops dead. Not good, not good. The Little League puts your son on waivers. That's not good, not good, not good. You have to use your Visa to pay off your MasterCard. Not a good day, not a good day. Your four-year-old tells you that it's almost impossible to flush a grapefruit down the toilet. Not good, not good, not good. And sometimes, no matter how much you pray, beg, or plead God for protection and prevention, and no matter how hard you work or how cleanly you live, sometimes a wheel still falls off. Sometimes the ship still develops a leak. The engine on the plane quits. The brakes on the car fail. If you're like me, you've had moments in your life when you cannot help but ask, God, where are you? Even worse is when you find yourself asking, God, what good are you? Or God, are you really good? We've said that God is good, and all the time God is good. But sometimes things happen to us that cause us to question even that statement. We think that if you are a good God and I'm trying to be a good person, why do these bad things happen to me? Don't worry. Let me let you know that things that are breaking bad will eventually be breaking good. I came home after not getting a job I wanted. True story, I was looking for a job after I finished school, and I'd heard all the guys at that time were working for one of the tool companies in Houston. Huge Tool, Reed Tool, all those tool companies. So I went to apply for them, and every time I went to apply for them, something happened. I did not get the job. And so I came home one day after finding out I didn't get the job and went in the house, and my father told me, I shared him what had happened. He shared with me, son, he said, son, let me just let you know. He said, God only wants what is best for you. And it still didn't resonate with me because I was feeling so low. And then not long after that, I was downtown getting my car worked on at the Goodyear place, at a place downtown on the corner of Fannin and Leland. And I was going to have some work done on it, and they were going to take about 4 hours. So I said to myself, well, what can I do for the next 4 hours? I'll tell you, I'm going down to the light company that they had an office at that time on Walker and Smith. And so I walked from Leland and Fannin all the way over to Walker and Smith, about 25 minutes. And when I arrived, I went downstairs to the Human Resource Department. I fill out an application, and someone took it and asked me, could I wait for just a minute? I say, well, sure, I got time. That's no problem, no problem. A lady came out and asked me, could I lift this beam up, wooden beam on the floor? She said, can you lift that beam up and put it up there? I lifted the beam up and put it up there. She said, okay, I'll be right back. Can you wait just a few minutes? I said, yeah, I can wait, I can wait. So I waited. Then she came back in a few moments and offered me an apprenticeship journeyman job in the metering department. I started working for the light company about within 2 weeks as a new apprenticeship class began. And after about a year, the oil boom went bust. And all the tool companies started laying off, with last hired, first fired. I would have surely been laid off. Then I looked back and said, thank you, God, for maneuvering my steps and not allowing me to get hired. Now that sounds, sometimes it sounds cold and callous and even somewhat condescending when what is actually meant to be comforting, but what if it is true that what if things that are breaking bad and eventually will break, will ultimately break good? That all leads us to a verse in the Bible that has been referred to as the Rosetta Stone of Scripture. To many, it is the greatest verse and the greatest chapter and the greatest book that has ever been written, the Bible. That's where we find ourselves this morning. Any list of the top 10 read, memorized, and searched scriptures in the Bible, this one always makes it into the top five. And we know that in all things, God works for the good to those who love him and have been called according to his purpose. Next to John 3:16, it may be the greatest verse in the Bible, and it is, to me, the most comforting and encouraging verse in the Bible, because if it is true, it puts sickness, suffering, and sorrow, and death in a totally different light. Romans 8:28 is an anchor for the soul. If our lives were ships at sea tossed by the waves and the winds, this verse would hold us steady, safe, and secure. Everyone in this room has weathered storms in your life, some more than others. I am no exception. I have lived with financial struggles, failures, and disappointments, family struggles, health issues, and the death of loved ones. On and on the list could go. Some of you have been through a lot worse. Some have lost spouses or children. A few have battled long-term illnesses. A number have lost jobs, careers, and dreams. A few of you may be in the middle of storms right now. And it doesn't even have to be a big storm. A series of smaller troubles, one right after the other, can seem unrelenting and overwhelming. Who among us hasn't asked the question, does life have to be so hard? Romans 8:28 does not answer that question. It offers something better. It gives us an anchor, something to hold on to during the storm. Here is the promise: God is good even when life is not. Romans 8:28. Listen to it again. And we know that all things work for the good to those, to those who love God and are the called according to his purposes. Let's dig a little deeper into this giant verse and break it down into the phrase we know. That is how it begins. Not we hope, not we wish, but we know. That is confidence born of experience. We know. What is the basis of our certainty? To answer that, we need to back up and consider the context. Romans is Paul's explanation of the gospel, what it is to which Christians have anchored their souls. The theme of the letter comes early in the first chapter. The gospel is the power of God unto salvation for all who have believed. first three chapters of the book of Romans outline the problem. It says, we all have sinned. Chapters 4-5 explain what God did about this, and that while we were yet still sinners, Christ died for us. Sin presents two problems. We confront the penalty of sin and the power of sin. Christ paid the price for our sins. That takes care of the penalty of sin, but we still struggle with sin. We live in a sinful world. That is the power of sin. The solution, chapters 6-8, that when we come to Christ, we become new creatures, new people. God gives us a fresh start, and the Holy Spirit comes to live in us to help us in our battle against sin. We are not our own. Does that mean we do not live, we do not face problems, or even must endure suffering? No, we are followers of Jesus. He suffered. Why should we expect not to? But rest assured, just as we are not alone in our struggle with sin, we are not alone when called upon to endure suffering and hardship. Note the foundation for this confidence that Paul lays in the larger passage I read. It makes the bold statement in our giant verse. He follows with five undeniable facts. Fact one, for those God foreknew, that simply means that this was not an afterthought. Two, that he also predestined. God had a plan, a goal for us, that is to be conformed to the likeness of his son, that he might be the first fruits among many brothers. God's goal has always been that we share the same destiny as Jesus. Verse 30, this is three, that those he predestined, he also called. That means he invited into his plan, and those he called, he also for justified. That he has forgiven us. He has completely and totally forgiven us for past sins, present sins, and future sins. And yes, glory to his name. And those he justified, he glorified. He will not leave us half done. He will see us through to the end. God is good all the time, and all the time, God is good. With Paul, the writer of our text, he tells us how we can face all of those things so differently from the rest of the world by doing three things. Number one, you can believe God's promise. You can believe God's promise. Look, we're going to read the next couple of verses, this verse and the next verse in pieces, so we can really understand what exactly is being stated. God never over-promises and under-delivers. He always under-promises and over-delivers, and he delivers what he promises. Listen again to the first part of this verse, and we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him. The first word in that is important is the word we. The promise is plain and it is true, but notice who the promise is for. The we in this verse are those who love God. There are only two types of people in the world, those who love and those who do not. There are people who say they love God who really don't love God. The promise is for those who truly love God. Paul goes on to clarify what he means by those who love God. He says, who having been called according to his purpose. They are the ones who are called. These are the people whom God has called to be a part of his family, and they have responded to that call by surrendering to Jesus Christ and becoming a child of God. You need to understand up front, this promise is not for everybody. It is only for those who know God, who love God, who worship God through his son, Jesus Christ. These are the people who know that what God is saying is true. It is dishonest to claim you don't know when you do know. It is foolish to claim you do know what you don't know. You should never hesitate to claim what you do know and can know. And this verse says one thing that we know, and that is that God causes all things to work together for our good, no matter how bad those things may be at the time. Not everybody can say, don't worry, everything will work out. Because for some, everything ultimately does not work out. This is not what this verse says. What this verse says is that at the end of the day, or even at the end of life, all things will be worked out by God for their good who know him. You may be thinking, well, wait a minute. I'm not a part of God's family. I've never trusted Jesus Christ, and everything seems to be working out for me. And I would just simply submit this to you to think about. What if what God's word says is true and you die without Jesus and spend eternity without God? Things really did not work out for you. The promise is so strong and so specific. It is made plain that God works all things out together for good. Not most things, not the majority of things, not a lot of things, but all things. God does not work all things out for good most of the time. He does work most things out for good some of the time. He does not do that. No. He works all things out together for our good all the time. You may not be seeing how that is happening today, but let me just alert you. You may not see how that is going to happen tomorrow. The promise is unequivocal. Since God keeps his promises, we can know that ultimately God will work all things out together for his glory and for our good. And as we flesh this out, you will see how true this is. Second point, you should receive God's plan for your life. You should receive that. You should receive, and I'm trying to get your me into this we. I'm trying to get your me into this we who know. Listen again to exactly what the promise says again. And we know that in all things God works for the good. The promise is not that everything works out. The promise is that God works everything out. And that is important for this reason. There's an old saying that the best laid plans of mice and men often go awry. It simply means that no matter how carefully a project is laid out, something can still go wrong. That is not true of God's plan. Nothing can ever go wrong with God's plan, and let me tell you why. Because the plan of God is the providence of God. Things do not work out coincidentally or accidentally, but providentially. The word providence comes from two words. The word pro means before. And the word video means to see. Providence means, simply means, to see before. And if you listen carefully, you can hear the word provide in the word providence. The promise of God simply means that God sees every event that is ever going to happen to me before it happens, and he has already provided for that event to fit into his plan for my life, so it will ultimately be for his glory and for my good. A London cardiographer, John Spilsbury, is credited with commercializing the first jigsaw puzzle around 1760. 250 years later, they are still popular in America as a way to pass the time and as a cheap form of entertainment. Jigsaw puzzles comes in all shapes and sizes. One thing has not changed in 250 years. It requires the fitting together of oddly shaped, interlocking, and totally different pieces. The key is always the picture on the top of the box. If you don't have that picture, you're gonna have a hard time. There are a lot of pieces that come into our lives. Some good, some bad, some straight, some crooked. How do they all fit together? The top of the box is God's plan for you. God makes sure that every piece fits so that the puzzle comes out perfect every time. Our first president, George Washington, had a profound appreciation for the providence of God in his own life. In his first inaugural address as the President of the United States, 44 years, some earlier, in the Battle of Monongahela, the then 23-year-old Colonel Washington in the British Army had two horses that were shot out from under him, and four musket balls passed through his coat. A Native American named Red Hawk later testified that he shot at Washington no less than 11 times at point-blank range and missed him. Of the 1,300 British soldiers, only 30 survived, and every other officer on a horse besides George Washington was killed. Years later on, after the battle, Washington returned to the site of that battle and surprisingly met the chief that was involved with that same tribe of Native Americans. The chief who led the battle recognized Washington immediately because the average soldier who fought was about 5'1" and Washington was 6'2". This chief made the following amazement statement, plotting how he realized that if they could kill the leader, the battle would be theirs. And so all of his warriors were to shoot at George Washington. He then made a startling prophecy, the chief did, that sounded like it came from a biblical prophet. Our rifles were leveled, rifles which for him, knew not how to miss. 'Twas all in vain, because a power far mightier than we shielded him from harm. He cannot die in battle. The Great Spirit protects that man and guides his destinies. He will become the chief of nations, and a people yet unborn will hail him as the founder of a mighty empire. The providence of God, that chief believed, was protecting George Washington. Because of the plan of God, God had a plan for George Washington, and his providence made sure that plan would be carried out. Understand this, everything does not work together for our good. It doesn't mean that everything bad, every bad thing that happens to you is good. It doesn't mean that every cloud has a silver lining. What Paul is saying is, when you get to the end of the road, God has a plan for you that everything will work out for his glory and your good. It is guaranteed by his providence. But this does not mean that every bad thing that happened to you is actually good. It does mean it is from the vantage point of eternity. When you look back on all that happened, and it will be clear that God took even the things that were genuinely bad and used them in such a way that they brought glory to God and good to you. Let me get to my last point. You will, if you accept him, you will achieve God's purpose. You will, if you accept him as Savior and Lord, his son Jesus, you will achieve his purpose. Listen to this verse again with the last word in mind. It says, and we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. There is a divine purpose in everything, and everything has a divine purpose. What is the ultimate, the final, the greatest purpose that God has with everything that happens to us? Look what it said in verse 29, for those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son. God's purpose for you in the final analysis is not to make you healthy, not to make you wealthy, not to make you happy, not to make you rich, and not to make you famous. God's purpose for you is to make you become just like Jesus. Do you know why? Do you know why that is the greatest good of all? Because if you are a believer, let's be honest, God doesn't always seem to be working things together for our good, as you know. For even for the most committed believers, life can be full of tragedy. Loved ones die. People get cancer. Jobs are lost. Children get hurt. It can happen to Christians as well as non-Christians. And if it didn't, every non-Christian would become a Christian. But here is the greatest thought. If there is no one greater than Jesus, then there is nothing better than to become like Jesus. It is not your definition of good. It is not your definition of good that God promises. It's God's definition of good. Let's just get real with where we live. Have you ever been bitter toward God because of something you think he caused to happen or allowed to happen? Have you ever been disappointed with God that he didn't give you something that you asked for or thought you should have? Have you ever been angry with God because he allowed something to happen to you or a loved one that you knew he could have prevented? Have you ever resented something about your physical appearance, the physical feature that you were born with that God gave you? Have you ever been upset with God because a situation didn't turn out the way you wanted it to? If any of those questions are true about you, and for almost all of us, at least one of them is, there is a truth you need to treasure, a fact you need to frame, and a principle you need to ponder, and it is this: no matter what happens in my life, God is always acting to accomplish his purpose, and always it's in my ultimate best interest. I'm sorry to pop your balloon, but the best thing that can ever happen to anyone is not to become Bill Gates rich, not to become Michael Jordan famous, not to become Donald Trump powerful, or Beyonce talented. The best thing to ever happen to anyone is to become just like Jesus. That is what God has called us for, created us for, and is using everything that happens to us, and it eventually connects everything together for good. I'm not gonna stand up here and tell you that life will always work out the way you want it to work out, but I can tell you that your life as a whole will work out the way God wants it to work out, and it will ultimately be for your good. No, there is nothing good about the bad things that people do and the bad things that happen to us. Sin is sin. Evil is evil. Tragedy is tragedy. Bad things are going to happen to the best of God's people. But the fight is fixed. And in the end, we win. Sometimes God works good around us. Sometimes he works good in us. Sometimes he works it through us. Hard times can prepare us to minister to others in their hard times. That doesn't make the rough spots any less rough, but it can produce good even from the worst of times. That's the promise of the Bible. Listen to Paul's explanation. Praise be to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of compassion and the God of all comfort. Oh God, who comforts us in all our troubles so that we can comfort those in any trouble with the comfort we ourselves have received from God. But just as the suffering of Christ flows over into our lives, so also through Christ our comfort overflows. That is why we can say God is good all the time, and all the time God is good. I read a story about a king and his friend who grew up together. The king and his friend grew up together, and they did everything together. Somewhere along the line, the friend got saved and worshiped God, and the king's friend had a saying. Say it all the time. Every time something happened, he said, "That's good. That is good. That is good." Well, one day they were out hunting, the king and the friend loaded the firearm of the king, who fired it, but it exploded, blowing the king's thumb off. But the friend said, "That is good." King looked at him and yelled and screamed, "This is not good," and had his friend thrown in prison. A year later, the king was out hunting when he was captured by some cannibals. They took the king back to their village, tied him to the stake, and he thought to himself, "This is not good. This is not good." Just before lighting the fire, one of the cannibals noticed the king's thumb was missing. And according to tribal tradition, you could not eat anyone who wasn't totally whole and complete. So they untied the king and let him go. When the king realized that his missing thumb was what spared his life, he thought about his best friend, whom he sent to prison. He immediately had him freed and brought him to the palace. He said to his friend, he said, look, I'm so sorry, you were right. It is good that my thumb was blown off. I'm so sorry for sending you to jail. That was not good. But the friend said, no, King. Having me thrown in prison wasn't just good, it was the best thing that you have ever done for me. The king said, what do you mean that is good? You have been in prison, in jail for a year. He said, that is good. Because if I had not been in jail, I would have been with you and my thumb is not missing. I want to tell you today, hold on. No matter what you go through, hold on. No matter what hand life gives you, hold on. Because God has your back. And I don't care how dark it looks. I don't care how bleak it looks. I don't care what happens to you. You keep holding on to God's changing hand. And he will, I tell you, he will bring you out. You'll be able to look back. I tell you, there are about 15 or 20 episodes in my life. I don't have time to tell you all of them, but I tell you, everyone, I can look back and say, look what God was doing. I did not understand it when I was going through it. I could not comprehend it when I was in the midst of it. But I tell you, just a little, if you just keep trusting him, just keep holding to his hand, when it's all over, you can look back and say, thank you, Lord. I did not know what you were going to do, but praise God, I held on to your hand. And now when I look back, I can see how you were strategizing, how you were planning, how you were arranging things to happen to me. And now I can give God the glory. Others may see what you don't look like what you've been through. Hallelujah, somebody. He has been keeping me all the way through. And I'm glad about it. And now I can stand and tell the story. God is good. And all the time, God is good. Hallelujah. And praise his name. Give God a hand and give yourself a hand. I'm trying to get your me into the we that you will know beyond the shadow of a doubt that you've been called by his purpose. How you've heard his calling? Have you answered the call? Have you heard him calling? Has he called you higher than you can answer the call that he has on your life? Praise God. He's an awesome God. He's a great God. And I'm glad to be on his side and not so much that he's on my side. The door is open. We want to extend the invitation because there may be someone here who your me has not connected with our we. And you'll see on the screen a QR code. You can scan that code and you can fill out that form and submit it, and we will help you to get to the place that you know that you are a part of the we. If you'd like, you can walk down the aisle, you can fill out that form, and we'll be in. We want you to be a part of the we.
Transition. Not all on earth. and just hold to God's unchanging hands. You gotta just hold to His hands, God's unchanging hands. To God's unchanging hands. Trust in Him who will not leave you. Whatsoever years may bring, and if thy earthly friends forsake,
is that never?
Hold to His hands. Come on, choir. God's unchanging hands. Hold to His hands. God's unchanging hands. Build your hopes on things eternal. And just hold unchanging hands.
Amen. We have one to come. Is there another today? We have one to come. That's good. Dear, we're so glad to have you today. We're going to ask you to go with Brother Bill there, and he's going to take care of you. We're going to get you on your way. Amen. 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 Praise His name. May we stand. Now, Lord, we thank You for this word. We thank You for what our eyes have seen, our ears have heard, and hands have handled concerning Your word of life. Now we ask You, O Father, to enable everyone in this room. If our me is not a part of the we, help us, O Father, that each one of us would know that we are a part of that group. Now, my Father, did dismiss us from this place, but never from Your ever-loving and everlasting presence. Bless our pastor wherever he is, and bless his wife, O Father. How we love You, how we praise You. Bless this one who's come today and those who are watching us virtually, that they would make a decision to trust Your Son Jesus as their Savior and Lord. This is our prayer and plea. We ask it all in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ, we pray. Amen. You are dismissed.